Enno is our keynote speaker, and we're very pleased to have him here. Enno Schmidt, his full name, is a painter, writer, and filmmaker, and he co-founded the Swiss organisation Initiative Grundeinkommen. You can read more about him in the programme, so I won't waste any more time. But he's going to tell us how he raised awareness in Switzerland about the, or he was part of the awareness raising movement in Switzerland, raising awareness about basic income to get it to the point where there's now going to be a referendum in that country. I know very well.
It's the same one in Switzerland. Maybe let's start with this point that it's impressive for me that ideas can be understood by people around the world. And that's impressive for me when I was in Montreal, for example, or I'm sitting here and I realize it's the same thing, the same idea, what's understandable by everybody, by every human being. So, and there you are at the point. It is a thing about a human being. And then about payment and what else. But first, this connects us all. And the funny thing and lucky thing or the thing I enjoy is to see that in different cultures, to see that in different forms of living, and at least every individual is another, is a different kind of culture, and to have this plurality, diversity by one idea. And that says the thing about what it is for me a very normal step in the history, that we have had the step to democracy, to human rights, that we have had the step to abolish slavery, that equal rights for women voting, for example, in Switzerland, we are very fast, it was in the 70s of the last century, and women get the same rights like men, so everybody in the world was more quick. And Switzerland is direct democracy needs more time. But to realize that this idea of an unconditional basic income as utopian it sounds as a very normal way in history. And because it's for me the same idea in the core point, like democracy, it attaches all these ideas that are going down at the moment in Europe, for example, that there is no democracy in real, if you see it correctly. And that we have situations close to slavery again. And that it's necessary to refresh and to rethink all these things the generations before us fight it for and give it to us as a gift in which we can live. And that we have to refresh it and to rebuild it. And the idea of an unconditional basic income, for example, is for me one of this point in history to refresh all the other things too. So by that I'm ready with a big word, and let's look to a small country in the middle of Europe, Switzerland. I am origin from Germany, I'm German, and I went to Switzerland to do this initiative. It is because of a project I did about culture and shaping in enterprises, and I met Daniel Handy in Basel. He's an enterprise, was an interesting enterprise. So biggest coffee house in Switzerland with atelier studios and so on. And we decided to start this initiative. And I say this because it's true. And basic income, unconditional basic income, and the movement at all is for me a question of biographies. And this is a story of Switzerland now, that two guys met, one from the outside, one from the entrepreneurial side, and decided to do it. And then we start this by doing events, big ones, websites, and so on. And for us, an important point has been that we could be generous, that we have had this huge space for events, that we can invite people, that we have a middle point in the city of Basel, and that people can come and then that we can act there. And if there's a question, how can we move in Ireland? So then I can say from my experience from Switzerland, it was important to have a headquarter, what is open for the people, where you can invite people, where you can act, where you can do things. And then what we did leads, because it is not for us, it is not a question We don't come from this social justice, for example. We don't come from any party. We don't come from any ideology. It is just to think about what is right for a human being, to decide by yourself, to be responsible, absolutely. So that is art, to be responsible. That you realize you are radical, absolute responsible for everything you are doing. And the other side, the entrepreneurial side, is what is an enterprise? It is working together. But what's a good enterprise? Working together by people who are individuals, who are self-responsible, who set their own targets and goals, and working together by a common goal. So this is our future vision, in a way. And from there we come. And this is another point what's important for me by the movement in Switzerland, that it starts not on the base of, let's say, old ideas or longer acting ideas like social justice or like we are for the poor ones, against the rich ones. It is not to be against anybody. It is just to be for this freedom, this point of responsibility and freedom. And because of that, we got a lot of awareness. Other people came to us and they forced this idea to make a public initiative. And that at least was the reason because of I went to Switzerland, because they have this direct democracy. And I will have a word, say a word about that. You know referendum, and referendum is done by the government or court. And in Switzerland, that's the same, it's possible, but there also is the right of initiative. And the right of initiative means that, for example, we both think that's a good idea with an unconditional basic income, and then we find a few one, and in Switzerland it's also not a mass of people. It is also a core of 30 people, and let's say 100 around, and then more 200 who helps by collecting signatures. And we can start an initiative. And when we collect 100,000 signatures by citizens, then this is a successful people's initiative. So you know in Switzerland there are 8 million people, not all are citizens, but let's say 8 million, I guess in North Ireland like 4.5 million. So it's enough to have 50,000 signatures in Switzerland, in Ireland, for example, and then it's legally binding. That's different. So normally you have petitions. In Germany, Susanne Wiest, for example, she did a petition to the government to introduce an unconditional basic income and a better tax, and she got 50,000 signatures by internet so fast that the server broke it down and everything don't work because the politicians don't count with people, population. They think they are government, but they don't need people to say what they want. A petition is only to say, please, could you? That comes from the Roman Empire, that was in the centuries, and every time that the people can say, please, could you? But a people initiative in Switzerland is from the sovereign. So the Swiss people think democracy in a very funny way. They think the people are the sovereign. So they don't think the government is the sovereign and the people can say and do something. But they really act in a serious way by democracy. That's really the mentality in Switzerland. And therefore, because of this tool, this political tool, we have this opportunity to act. And that's different by the other countries. When I look to Germany, for example, or other countries, that we have this wonderful thing that we can act, and we have this human initiative, and it's legally binding, and it leads to a public vote. And when the population will say the majority, yes, we want to introduce it, then it is a target for the government to do what the people want. So this is a simple way in Switzerland, and at least there are a lot of questions. One is, do you think that it's successful, this popular vote? And I think, no, it don't be successful in the way that the majority will say yes. But our goal is that we say if it's 25% or more, then it's successful for us. And I give you an example for democracy, for the process, to realize that democracy is a process. It's not just to say yes or no. There has been in Switzerland a public vote about to abolish the army, the whole army. Threw it away. For the Swiss people, the army was a holy cow after the Second World War and this awful things by the National Socialism in Germany. So it was awful, it was shocking, this idea, to have this idea, like to have the idea of unconditional basic income for everybody. It's unimaginable. But then, by the public vote, 36% of the population voted for it by yes, quit the army. And that make that the army loses its rule, it loses its image, it goes down. And I think in the last year there was a public vote if the Swiss people want that the government buy new aircraft fighters, and the majority said no, we don't need that. So democracy is a process, that's what I want to say. And it's not yes and no and then you fall in down or hype, but it is a process of consciousness. And that's the main point for me and for us, that we want to figure consciousness, that we want to move and change perspectives, the things people look to, for example, income and work, education, freedom, personality, because all this is around this idea of unconditional basic income, and therefore it's for me the main key in the world in the moment, because it enforces the people more to do what they want, to say, to act, to think what they want, to be thrown back to themselves, what is awful but necessary. In this situation, what I see from Switzerland and what worries me, what's going on in Europe with the EU, with this driving to the next war, all this enforced by outside, and that I think to enforce the people is the key to have more intelligence in society and to not be leaded to the next catastrophe. I would like to say a few words more, and then let's talk with each other about this idea of an unconditional basic income and a few things around. So what I said is, for me, for us, it's not so much to have an old impact on old line what we are going on by social justice. That does not mean that we are for social justice, of course we are, but to have a new approach. And for me this thing is so interesting, this idea, because it touches so many things. For example, to think about what taxes are. You have the question, how can we pay it? And then you are looking, where is money? For example, the rich people or what else. But you can also say, I think about what taxes are. And it's interesting for me to realize, first of all, for what taxes are. So it's so obviously, but I say, it is for income. Taxes are always for income. Income for the people who are asked to do the things that we ordered the state, the government to do. Taxes are for nothing else than incomes. And the next is, what are prices we pay as a consumer? Consumer prices. And to realize they are nothing else than incomes. So the stuff, this beautiful thing, costs nothing. What it costs is the income of the people who did it, from the resources to all the machines and computers who built that, the transport, to think about what prices are, that they are income, nothing else. Material stuff costs nothing. Nature needs no money. So you can do that, think about that. Even taxes are in the price of this. So to think, who carries the taxes? We think, yeah, the working class, people who are working. are the rich ones. But from there, from where the money comes is from the consumer prices. So when I have to pay higher taxes, I will higher my price for the consumer. And every company what did not do in this way will be bankrupt. So to realize it is a bit possible to think new about this, how the things are going on. And that's a bit an illusion to say taxes on income and not to see, yeah, but paid by the consumer. The taxes are in the consumer prices. They have to be in the consumer price. The price for resources are in the consumer prices. Taxes on resources are in the consumer prices. Taxes on income, taxes on finance transfer, all taxes are in the price for the consumer, at least, carried by us as a consumer. It's not to say it's good or bad, it's just to say, oh, come on. And taxes are for income, they are also for income. And loans for income. So money is always from men to men. Money is always from men to men and not for stuff. An institution costs nothing. A handy smartphone car costs nothing. What it costs is income for people who did it. Income for the people who did the framework, the state work for this shaping and building the stuff. It's just important for me at this point, by an enlightenment to the situation we are living in a global work share situation. So for example, you can say, a friend of mine said that often, dress out everything what's not produced in Ireland. So I don't know what it looks like, but the most, so to become clear, we are in a work relationship in the world, globally. And that throw up the question about what is the right tax. And this is important for me to realize that today, for example, we pay the basic income in the consumer prices. It is a part of the consumer prices. And with non-conditional basic income, we just change this point that what was depending on what else becomes independent, becomes unconditional, and it's the same in the prices that we paid in the prices. And therefore, the thought about payment is for me in the same way like an unconditional basic income, a new question and a fantastic, interesting field to come up to the current perspective and view on our work life today. And therefore, we in Switzerland, we don't fix a number of an unconditional basic income. We don't fix a special way to finance it. Because, and you can taste it by you yourself, for example, when you hear an unconditional basic income and what it is, then the soul comes open, mind becomes open, and it does something. And when you come with numbers, oh, that's another way. That's another construction in your soul. So, and my experience is, people are very strong to ask, to say, yes, it's a nice idea, but you can't pay it. It's not to finance. It's not possible. And then you are needed to say, okay, I count it for you. But the result is that then the people are computering, counting numbers. And that has nothing to do with the idea. And at least, if it is to finance, that's not a reason to do it. To can finance it is not a reason to do this step. So these are problems for us and for me too, that we also do computing and counting that. But to know the question, first of all, the question is not how we can finance it. And not so much how we'll work further on than with non-conditional basic. But for me, the point is that people are immediately touched by this question, or you said to this question, what my life is, what is my life? So to be falling back to yourself, to realize that's my life in here. And Yeah, and to be angry because of the freedom. Not, first of all, the freedom of you, because you will do some silly stuff. I'm intelligent, and then the next is that I know that I'm not it. I will do some. Maybe I lost my life by doing unresponsible things. So this soul-y things, spiritual things, I guess they are the most important points. And then the discussion is going further on. So therefore we try to, and in every time to have in your brain, it is for all. And that's what often people forget. They say it is for all, but they don't think it is for all. For example, the government in Switzerland argued against an unconditional basic income. They counted it and said it's not to finance. They know it is for all, but they count only social welfare. So some things are very easy to say, but very, very difficult to realize in yourself, for everybody, for all. That means for the rich one, for the crimes, for all the people I really don't like, for all the people who are evil, for all the people who are ugly or whatever, for all. And that means for the rich one, too, for all these bankers, for all the bodies, for all. And then it becomes difficult because you can't be against someone by acting for an unconditional basic income, but just for something. And we are so, in our behavior, we need to be against, then we are strong. So, but now it's a new century, a new challenge to be strong without being against, but being for something. And that's the brilliant point for me, that an unconditional basic income is not so much how many other people agree with me, but how what I can develop me myself by this idea. It gave me so many impulses for development or for seeing what is necessary and what's a problem and what's going on by my own force. And that's for me the center point, the core point in this unconditional basic income, that it is really a new idea. And that means it's not so in that way in the method the same like the ideas of the last century. The method is different. The method is that it starts by me and my biography, it starts by what I want to do, and what I, yeah, and in which I have the power to do it. And not so much, we talked about yesterday, not so much the view to who will agree. At least this is the responsibility of the other people. But more that I'm really in touch and in the same way like this idea is. And then I guess for me that's our target and that's our thing we have to do to make it visible, to bring people in touch with this idea. Not to bring them to convince with it, that's their thing, but to bring it to the people as a message that they can come in touch with it. And that's because we try to have as much medias, as much public awareness, and for example by collecting signatures, not to discuss with the people too long, a bit, yes, because we are friendly, but not to bring them, to win them over, to bring them to or whatever else, that costs too much time. You know, we have to have a strategy. We have not all the time. We have not all the power. We need to fix the power at that point where it's efficient. And that was to, for example, by collecting signatures, to not to discuss too long, because we make this initiative that then people can discuss how long they want. But first to have this point to vote about it and to have it as a nationwide discussion. And one last point, briefly, what was important for me by collecting signatures. So you can imagine how it is when I say, come on, let's go on the street. We ask the people if they are for an unconditional basic income. And we go outside and the people have really other problems and other thoughts. And that's the last one what they want to hear. And they look to you and they're like, who are you? So it's a bit you need a bit to step on the street to the public, on the places. On the other hand, that enforces something what is good for the whole idea. It's more than to do it by the internet. It is a human step. And then it's something that's very great to hear from people. That's what I'm waiting for. Unconditional basic income, why it's so late? Some people who agree immediately, they don't think. Some people who are not so clear about what it is, it's a minimum wage, I'm for a minimum wage. And we said, no, it's not a minimum wage, but we don't discuss too long. So some signatures are by people who thought it is for social justice, and it is at least. And some people are absolutely against, and that's that you have to carry. And the thing was that we thought it's such a good idea. The people will come and collect signatures, and it's very easy. And then we realized that's not so easy. And then because of the need and pressure for us, how can we do it, what's going on? And I say this, that is part of the story, to be in need, to be a bit depressive, to have problems, it's part of the story. Then it grows up what was called generation-based income, that was more the younger one. And they said, yeah, you old guys, you have to do your thing. We are fresh. And they did the collecting of signatures in a way that there are achievable targets. That, for example, we say, okay, this weekend we meet, and then at the end of the day, we count the signatures and we have a winner of the day. And it is, we go by different teams in the city, and it becomes a sporty competition, contest, and that we have goals that we say at the end of the month, not 100,000, but maybe thousands more. And that's achievable. That's a target. You can get it. And so it becomes a way by success, that every step is a success. Not every step is the losing, every step is a success. And it's common goals, common targets. And in different cities to have contests, if Bern is better than Basel, or Zurich is better than Geneva. So this sporty aspect, and the aspect that it is not pushing, but pulling. So to pull the interest, to pull the energy, to make spaces in which people like to go with, to take part, because it's a living carpet. That's an important experience for me, for the method of unconditional basic income. It's not pushing. It's not going with old thoughts. It's to go by yourself. So it was, in this case, it was mainly Paula Rappert, a woman, and then a few friends of her, and they did it. And they called this first Tour de Bal, like Tour de France. This is this bicycle run. Tour de Bal for unconditional basic income. And so this sporty atmosphere, and this going ahead, and every time, in with being pretty, being attractive, attractive by the website, attractive by the photos, well done, take care by the people, look to the people, take care by the people. So to have this aesthetics is for us in Switzerland a main point of the success. Not to think we have such a good idea, the input is brilliant, we don't need a form. No, we need an aesthetic, brilliant, beautiful form. And at least, you know, people go to what it is, what's attractive. If you don't go, must don't go to what may be right, but is ugly. It has to be beautiful. And that's what we are trying as far as we can. That it is not a good idea in a tired form. But that is, first of all, it is a brilliant form. It is fun to take part. Even in a small way. So this is for me the experience by collecting signatures. First, to define by yourself what you can do. Don't set yourself in pressure what has to be done. No, nothing has to be done. It's just what I can do. And as long and as good as I can and not more, not this old stuff by being forced to do the holy thing for time after your life. So life is now. And acting for unconditional basic income is really brilliant and fun and so interesting. And that's the thing, and that's attractive. That's what I learned by this collecting signatures, and to have achievable goals, targets, achievable. Not far, not we have to save the world, it's a bit far. But to have a next step, and to look that this step is successful, and then we are successful. And then we have the braveness to say, next one, we are strong, we are good. So this is, in a way, a normal entrepreneurial behavior by a good enterprise. And we came to that without thinking about that before, and came to that it needs this vacuum, in a way, that's going in front of it, having the people who do it, and building a living carpenter that the other people can step on, acting with, doing their own things. So this is a few experiences or a few points from this Swiss initiative, and at least it has a worldwide movement, and we all have our parts in every country, every culture, every individual. Thank you.